Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a podcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. I am your host, Ashutosh Garg, and today I'm delighted to welcome an accomplished professional from the UAE, Mr. Brendan McKittrick. Brendan, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Ashutosh, and thanks for having me on your prestigious show.
Thank you. Brendan is the chairman of the board of Aerobrand. He's the chairman of HBAN Dubai, and he's a member of the Irish Business Network. So, Brendan, let's first talk about Aerobrand. What did you do?
So, Aerobrand is my little favorite child business at the moment. I started my life in a lot of big projects after I came from college. Then I went into entrepreneurship where I set up my own businesses. Mm-hmm. And I guess the wheel has gone full circle because I've gone through some of the biggest companies in the world at sea level. And now I've gone back to my roots to set up a brand new enterprise in aviation. Mm-hmm. And the timing has actually been incredible. So like everything, when you follow your heart, everything falls into place.
Correct.
And what we've done is we've looked at aviation, which is an area I have a lot of expertise in. Mm-hmm. And we've decided that a lot of the systems, which date back to the 60s and 70s, mm-hmm. are very dated and very inagile. So what we decided to do was to rewrite some of the core systems using things like blockchain, distributed ledger, mm-hmm. artificial intelligence, but getting an outcome which is much more compatible with today's fast-moving environment.
Fascinating. So before this, you were the CIO slash CTO of Excellia, which, when I was reading about you, is processing business worth $250 billion, $250 billion a year. What was your motivation to give up all this and start off on your own?
Again, it wasn't a decision of the head, I can tell you. Mm-hmm. I'm with five beautiful children, most of them wanting to spend as much time as possible in college. Mm-hmm. It wasn't driven by any of the sort of financial gains you can make working at that level. Right. What drove me was to make a difference. I really want to, to say I've lived a career, I've worked a career where I made decisions. I took the road less traveled. Mm-hmm. And for me, $250 billion worth of tickets going through a system, which is 30 years old, looking at that saying, there's an easier way to do this, right? We've got these massive global settlement systems. And before now, it was all an issue of trust. So we always had this intermediary, mm-hmm. whether it was the financial system, the health system, whoever, there's always an intermediary that brokers all of these transactions. And we need that. And they've served a good purpose. But now with the likes of distributed ledger technologies, mm-hmm. that's automated. That's in the middle. That you and I can now transact peer-to-peer. Mm-hmm. We can send each other money, mm-hmm. digital money. We can sign smart contracts, mm-hmm. which are both binding on you and me, and there's absolutely no middleman. So I wanted to bring that paradigm to aviation and say, how could we transform aviation? For example, in loyalty, we all know the loyalty systems don't talk to each other. Mm-hmm. They're very hard to sort of stock up on things, and then they're not very liquid. There's only certain things you can spend mm-hmm. them on. Mm-hmm. Whereas we were saying, why don't we have a digital wallet where you can send a token which represents value to that airline? Mm-hmm. And indeed, the token could represent value in the entire airline. So, you're sitting at the gate, your flight is cancelled, next thing, ding, ding on your phone, into your digital wallet comes compensation tokens because your flight has just been cancelled. Mm-hmm. And you can use them to book a hotel, go for some food, book mm-hmm. another flight, or go to the ATM and cash them out. That would be the vision around that. Then in cargo, everybody has the age-old problem. Where's my cargo? Where's my stuff? And it's a common challenge is track and trace. And some of the biggest airlines I worked with still have that challenge. So what we need is a global digital commons where we can all collaborate together and preserve privacy and at the same time give the customer the best experience where they can see where their things are. One of the things we have done, one of the first things we've done is a smart contract for airports, mm-hmm. which, although we have all the charges built in at the back, mm-hmm. we've only disclosed the landing charges. So what we do is we allow an airport mm-hmm. to put their landing charges into a smart contract so that stops revenue leakage, it stops disputes, and it also gives transparency to the airline and the airport at the same time on this common digital commons where they can both look up their status between each other. So that's very exciting. So there's lots of little things like that we're starting to chip away at.
Just absolutely fascinating. I mean, I wish I'd, this technology had been launched many, many years ago when I was traveling 20 days a month. But I sincerely hope you'll go to Heathrow you know, an airport close to you, where I must have lost my bag at least a dozen times.
Right.
That's another story. So moving on, Brendan, from a large organization like Accelia to a startup like AeroBand, what have been some of your challenges as you have built this business?
Well, when you move from having three secretaries to doing everything yourself, that's a tough one. You got to get up and about all the administration, you know, but I'm not precious about that. Mm-hmm. The challenges would be building the right team. Mm-hmm. Whilst it's a challenge, I already know who I want. Mm-hmm. Getting the same attention in the rooms, because when you're running the global settlement system, you can walk into most rooms and people will, you know, have time to listen to you. So I kind of figured out who are the closest people in the industry who believe in me as a person. Mm-hmm. And that was an enlightening experience, because there's folks who came up to me and backed me financially, not knowing my business plan, just saying, I'd like to financially go back you, Brendan, because we know you're a man of your word and we know that you're going to achieve something interesting. Right. Right. That was very empowering, I have to say. I was very flattered, mm-hmm. including some ex-CEOs that I worked for. Mm-hmm. And again, back to the challenges, I suppose the biggest shift for us, we started in 2019 and we won the FinTech of the Year startup in Malta. Mm-hmm. Very honored to win it against some really good competition. And we rolled into 2020, very optimistic, you know, we've got these things. But we did find there was a great resistance in the aviation industry to just shift, to do things differently. Even if they're, you know, once they're not too broken, right. They kind of have that mindset, look, we're break even. We're happy with that. It's a very low level, very low standard of expectation in aviation. For example, I gave a presentation in 2019 and I declared that, you know, it's a $900 billion industry, mm-hmm. and of which it was about $28 billion in profits, which worked out at 3% or 3.5%.
Right.
And the actual average ticket, I was when I saw it first, the value, I had to check it a few times of saying, mm-hmm. This is over an 800. So I mentioned at one of my presentations that airlines are not very smart. Mm-hmm. And I was challenged afterwards by a C-level chap from an airline who said, I didn't like that comment. It's not very fair. And I said, I'm coming from the industry. I say it respectfully. Mm-hmm. He said, give me one example where we're not smart. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, first of all, I know who you are and I know your airline. I flew in on your airline. Mm-hmm. And because I ran the revenue accounting systems for most airlines in the world in my previous job, I knew the revenue and the profit. You know, sort of levels. Mm-hmm. And I said to him, I flew in on your aircraft to this conference, this airport. I then took a taxi to the hotel. Mm-hmm. The taxi man made more money on me than you did. Mm-hmm. And he went, wow, not very smart. And I said, no, this is the point. I'm not criticizing the airlines for the sake of it. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is there's a lot of money lost from the point of, you know, sale all the way to the point of collection. There's so many middlemen. The money gets eaten down to, so the actual profit is $6 per ticket. Wow. Then $6 on an $800 billion industry. Wow. So, you know, something is fundamentally wrong. And I predicted that the margin, the 3.5%, was getting further compressed and would go to zero in 2020. Little did I know it went, you know, minus 97% on a year. So it really got impacted. But what it did do, to your question about the challenge of the mindset, it shifted the mindset to how do we restart an industry that's effectively dead, mm-hmm. and how do we reduce costs now that we're in the downtime? Mm-hmm. You know, letting people go, stopping aircraft flying is fine, but you've got to change the model so that it's much more efficient. So that's where we came into that conversation around, you know, distributed ledger, AI type things, you know.
Very interesting. And, you know, you did speak about artificial intelligence and blockchain managing a lot of the challenges that are faced by airports and airlines. Would you like to give me some examples of where you've really implemented this?
So we're an early stage company. So we've only released our first product and we're talking to some partners who would have a large body of airports on mm-hmm. their books. So what we're targeting is one or two airports mm-hmm. who are willing to try out new technology. So we're at the very early stages. So you heard it here first, right? Mm-hmm. We haven't actually announced the smart contract publicly because we want to tailor it to suit the needs and, you know, to trial it maybe over 6 months. So we're going to take our time. We're in no rush, but we want to do it right. And, you know, there's only one first time, and that's really important. So we're targeting a very big airport in the Asia region, not too far from me. Mm-hmm. And we're targeting a very big airport in North America for starters, and maybe one in Europe. We're looking for three, but we've got two on the radar. So what we're going to do with them is say, let's run this in parallel to your traditional system, mm-hmm. and let's see how much revenue leakage this saves you. Mm-hmm. Because these airports do auditing on their charges as well. Mm-hmm. That's number one. And number two is the whole experience. What we want to do is to have a turnaround, mm-hmm. an automated turnaround for an aircraft. So there's so many charges that could be applied to an aircraft. I think there's 130, wow. of which probably about 60 constitute 90% of the amount of revenue. Mm. So we're going to sort of crawl our way up that list and make this an automated turnaround for an aircraft, mm. and to handle all the exceptions. So what we have is business rules, and we have expression drivers. And the folks who are doing this, we have a small team in Malta, and they're 20 years building cost management systems for aviation. So they're super experts, and it's nice to work with experts. As I mentioned before, getting really good people. Mm. So one of those guys in the room, the architect, I just sit back and I just learn, you know, and my area is more to cargo and revenue, but they're experts on the cost side. So that cost contract plays into our bigger plan. Mm. And our bigger plan is to build core systems like revenue accounting. Amazing. So revenue accounting is the only system that gives the CFO his flown revenue, not how many people booked, not how much revenue is expected, mm. but how much revenue did you collect on that flight when you closed that door? Mm. And it allows for things like taxation, you know, the charges in countries and all of that. And when you have all that revenue figured out, you bring back your smart contract. Now you have the revenue and the cost. Mm. So you have true profit management. And that's really our golden target, is the profit management for the CFO. So he can see all this on a dashboard.
Incredible. So I'm now going to move to your other interest, which is the Halo Business Angel Network. You're the chairman of HBAN.
In Dubai.
Tell me a little bit in Dubai. Tell me about the kind of work you do at this network.
Yeah, so this is fascinating. This is a passion. This is just a formalization of what I've always mm-hmm. done in my spare time. Ask my wife, is there such thing as spare time? Mm-hmm. So people have come to me over the years. Obviously, I had companies back in the day in the late 90s, early 2000s, and I sold those. Then went back into the corporate world and I worked in the Royal Flight of Oman, which was absolutely my passion personified. Mm-hmm. And I had similar jobs like that. I built some national security systems right. for some countries in the Middle East. So all of that was great. It was enterprise level, you know, big teams, big budgets. And always people would come to me and say, I'm starting off a new idea. And I would just give as much time as I could because I really enjoy that. So the Halo business, so basically that's the... It's an angel network, the Halo Business Angel Network, HBAN is the short name. Right. It was founded in Ireland and driven by the Irish government. Mm-hmm. So Enterprise Ireland, who you may or may not have heard of, mm-hmm. is the biggest seed investor in the world.
Wow.
Out of a small country like Ireland, which is shocking because I hadn't realized that, but it's mm-hmm. a huge credit to them. And I did have some interactions with them in the 1980s when I was finishing college. Mm-hmm. We got backed on some little projects that, you know, helped us build those businesses. And mm-hmm. I'll be forever thankful to them for that. Mm-hmm. What they do now is they take a small part of equity in the high potential companies, mm-hmm. but then they have an accelerator program, which is complemented by an angel network, which is folks that say, show us the best companies coming through the pipe. You know, we might throw anything as small as $25,000 up to $500,000. And, you know, it is an element of speculation because the companies are not fully formed, mm-hmm. but they are revenue generating. They're hot property, let's say. So I run the Dubai chapter of that, which really says, show us the top of the top. So these are all the top companies, but shave off maybe two or three of those every quarter mm-hmm. so that I can get the right people in the room and they know they're going to get a really good showing of top companies. Mm-hmm. And that's essentially the key ingredient in the Dubai version. Mm-hmm. And so far it's been good. It's been a slow build because everyone in the room has got to be the right person. Maybe. And we've built a small cadre of folks. It's still in single digits, mm-hmm. Probably get to double digits by the end of the year. And then we'll sort of see where it goes from there.
Interesting. And what do you look for before you decide to refer a potential investee to your network?
So investee or investor?
No. If I'm looking for money,
right.
I come to HBAN, and then you must be referring it to a lot of angels.
So there's a pipeline. There's a well-defined pathway, right? Mm-hmm. They're backed by the Irish government through Enterprise Ireland, and they're probably mm-hmm. on the high potential accelerator program. And they feed into the HBAN who say, give us the best who are looking for money and we'll match them with folks who have money. Then my template or on top of that is to say, just pick the top two or three in that quarter who are looking for cash, will probably get the cash with or without us. Mm-hmm. I like that because that means they're going to succeed anyway. Mm-hmm. And then we can put them in front of some really good guys here who may help them come into the region as well. Mm. And help them springboard out of Europe or out of Ireland or wherever they're operating. Mm. There's a tendency in Ireland to look towards US and UK. Now, with Brexit, the UK is a little bit more trickier than it used to be. Mm-hmm. The US is still a hotspot for Ireland, but it's a big sell and a big distance. And it generally means moving your HQ to a different time zone.
Right.
Europe is attractive, but linguistically challenging. You know, you're going to be up against French companies in France and Spanish companies in Spain. Unless you're really, really, really good and somewhat unique, that's going to be challenging because then you need a local presence. You need folks who speak the local language and understand the culture. That's an essential. And that's for anywhere. But with the Middle East, you have such a melting pot of folks here. Lingua franca is English. Everybody speaks English to a high degree. So you can land in here with a really, you know, wheel spinning before you touch the ground type landing model. And the folks here who are investing in you could probably make a phone call and open a few doors as well.
Interesting. And at what stage do you look for an exit? How long is your appetite for investment?
It varies a lot, I have to say, because the way the HBAN is structured, there's obviously hard-nosed business criteria being applied by the investors. There's also the sentimental value I've picked up very quickly because it's almost like I'm helping a business from my own hometown. And there's been a trend of folks saying there's little small HBAN chapters in the west of Ireland in small rural areas. Mm-hmm. And there's even a possibility of a unicorn coming from one of these, right? So you have folks sort of going in saying, show me the best in that sector, in that region, like Heltec. Now you have a place like Galway in the west of Ireland. And Galway is a beautiful city. Mm-hmm. When we say city, we don't mean city by, you know, Indian standards or...
No, I've been there.
Okay, fantastic. But mm-hmm. Galway's become maybe the global center of medtech.
Wow.
It produces the most medical devices in the world now. Again, some of that is American companies and local companies. But what happens is the multinational comes in, folks come out of college, they go through the system, and of course they have an appetite for creating something, to see an opportunity.
Right.
The entrepreneurial ones sort of peel off at different stages, and they create really, really powerful companies in those niches. But there's a great symbiotic relationship with the parent company that they left, who says, hey, if you're leaving us, we'll invest a few quid in you as well, because we really believe in you as a guy, but we're not going to stop you on your, you know, trajectory to your personal passion and your personal growth. So there's all this synergy, and that's facilitated a lot by Enterprise Ireland, who frankly are doing a fantastic job of greasing those wheels to turn and keeping that connectivity. So HBAN is another spin-off of those mechanics. It's backed by Enterprise Ireland, and it was Enterprise Ireland who approached me to help with the HBAN chapter here locally. So it's an ecosystem that's ever growing, and it's quite powerful. So the question of the exit is somewhat sentimental as well, I've noticed. Obviously, people are saying, I'm putting in a few quid, there's an element of speculation, but they would like to see, you know, within a 3-year explosion of business and value, and maybe an acquisition. So there's been a track record of about 300 million gone in, and the return has been quite, I, off the top of my head, I don't know the return, but it's been quite attractive. Mm-hmm. It's one of the selling points. It's been very, very high. So there's kind of that 3-year expectation that the most successful companies will be flipped over or acquired.
Very interesting. So I, Brendan, I have time for one or maybe two questions now. I wanted to ask you again, relating to HBAN. You must be talking to many, many startup entrepreneurs who are looking for funding. What, in your opinion, are some of the challenges you have seen startup entrepreneurs face?
I love that question because I've been on both sides.
Right? And I agree. You're a startup.
I've been the startup entrepreneur. I've been in the multinational. I've also been on the acquiring side. So in my previous role, I did some technical due diligence on acquisitions, and the acquisitions we had went from 20 million to 650 million, right? So different size corporations, completely different metrics. So the metrics and the conversation in the room. Mm-hmm. Now, we did interview some companies that we didn't acquire. Mm-hmm. And maybe if I spoke about them, mm-hmm. and they were sort of folks where I said, look, guys, 20 years ago, I walked into Air France mm-hmm. and we had an innovation in aviation, which was radical, right? So I walked in thinking, hey, we're going to change the world. Air France, CTO, this is going to be an amazing meeting. So I was just short of being lifted out of the room in a straitjacket, being told I was absolutely crazy.
Okay.
Because we developed a bridge between the legacy systems from the 1960s, the TPF systems, and an Oracle Live database. So we had live availability, which meant our booking engine didn't need to go to the mainframe. It used this numerical availability, it's called NAVS.
Right.
And it was able to say how many seats were available and book those seats without booking on the mainframe to get the price. Because traditionally you have to book the mainframe to get the price of the ticket. So what happened was you had this look to book ratio. Mm-hmm. And this look to book ratio meant the amount of people looking versus people booking. So the lookers were costing you money and the bookers were making you money. Mm-hmm. And if it was 100-1, you'd have, you know, 100 people wasting your time, not wasting your time, but consuming energy and power and causing it.
Correct.
So we overcame that. And I thought, this is brilliant. Walked in the room, long story short. I also said we could probably do self-check-in. Folks could check themselves in. And that was like, are you crazy? You know, and Air France didn't say anything different to any other airline. All the airlines would have said the same at the same time. Why? Because they have a certain approach to technology that I've learned over the years. And there's a reason for it, because it's a highly safe environment where you don't make changes unless necessary. And a lot of CEOs come from the pilot background who are safety driven. So it's not a fault in the system. It's just it's a cautiousness you need to be aware of. So a lot of companies came into me and said, we've got this great app. You can, you know, upgrade the business in the lounge, and you can do this and you can do that, and on board you can do it. And I'm saying, great. How do you talk to the legacy systems?
Mm-hmm.
Those 1960s. And they go, I'm sure there's an API. And I say, no. You might be on the phone talking to people. Some of the bridges, you know, would be voice caps. But having APIs is sort of an assumption of startups. Yeah. So one of the biggest challenges for startups is you've got to be backward compatible for most part. You've got to be able to talk to the legacy systems or rewrite them. Mm-hmm. And I don't suggest you rewrite them. That's what we're doing. We're rewriting it. And because of that challenge, I've seen so many times and I've lived through it. I'm creating a new core system that these new guys coming in with great stuff, way beyond what I can even imagine, they're going to talk into my ecosystem called Aeroblock. Mm-hmm. So instead of 6 months to 12 months of development, I'm going to, my target in my mind is literally build me a working product in 2 weeks,
mm-hmm.
but do it in my Aeroblock sandbox, mm-hmm. connecting to live feeds of all the information you need, whether it's taxation as a service, proration as a service, live location of aircraft, you know, city codes, airport codes, whatever it is. All that will be in your ecosystem so that you can show me a product that now talks to the legacy system through our interface. And you can accelerate it. We'll back you. We're going to launch the coin. So we have a fund. We'll back them with a digital fund. Mm-hmm. And those folks would then go and own their IP, because I want them to succeed. I don't want to take all the apples from the orchard. I want those guys to come into the ecosystem, be super successful. Mm-hmm. And if they can write applications better than me,
mm-hmm.
then they'll thrive in the system better than I will. That's how open it is. So the Aeroblock sort of substrate,
mm-hmm.
is the digital commons we're handing back to the industry to be governed by, you know, some ex-CEO of a big airline with a governance. And that will be owned by the industry itself, not by us. Our IP lies in Aero Labs, where we build the solutions and deploy on the Aeroblock, but the Aeroblock we hand back. And the Aeroblock will fund itself through transaction, a very thin transaction slice.
Wow. Brendan, on that note, we have to end. Thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking to you.
Absolute pleasure for me.
Thank you for talking to me about your journey from Axelia to Aeroband and you know, all the great work that you're wanting to do with Aeroband. As I said, I wish you had started this 20 years ago when I was traveling so much.
Yeah.
But good luck with your startup and all the very best.
Thank you, Ashok. And if you're ever in Dubai, give us a shout. We'll go for a cup of coffee. I know you're a man of tremendous achievement yourself, and I know you'll probably be very modest about it. I saw your aerospace role with Lockheed Martin and Hughes in Asia, the head, and also the head of British Tobacco and YPO for 27 years, and many, many books to your name. So if you do come this far, we're having a cup of coffee and you're going to tell me your story.
I look forward to that. Thank you. Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast, a platform that brings you knowledge, experience, and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website, www.tbcy.in, to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for The Brand Called You.